Good evening, good day, everyone. Thank you for joining our panel, our first panel of the day.
Gracias por estar en este panel.
All right, we will give a couple of minutes more for folks to gather to join our panel. All right. One more minute. All right. Again, thank you everyone for joining us this morning, this afternoon or evening, wherever you're joining from. My name is Galina Angarava. I come from the Abzai clan of the Ihirit Nation of the Buryat people in Siberia. I serve as the Executive Director of Cultural Survival. We are almost 50 years old. We are an indigenous-led organization that advocates for indigenous people's rights and supports indigenous communities' self-determination, cultures, and political resilience since 1972. Today, I'm speaking from the lands of the Ohlone people, which is now known as the San Francisco Bay Area. I want to welcome everyone to panel one of our three-day conference on restoring and protecting our native languages and landscapes. And at this panel, we will have a conversation about the state of indigenous languages as measure of indigenous rights. Just a few housekeeping items. If you speak English, you can follow us on Swapcard. The webinar is also available in Spanish and Russian. You can also follow us on social media, YouTube and Facebook. That those channels on YouTube and Facebook are available in English only. If you need interpretation, please go to panel one on Swapcard. On the left-hand side, you will access the interpretation by clicking on the link. Please also fill out the survey. The link to the survey is available above the link to the interpretation. You can also join our live discussion by clicking on the live discussion button on Swapcard. So just a few housekeeping items so that everyone can join and listen in. And thank you again for joining us this morning. I'm thrilled to be moderating the session today. I'm honored to present a panel of remarkable Indigenous advocates and activists who over the years have contributed to the advancement and the implementation of human rights and the rights of Indigenous peoples in their own communities, in their own countries, and globally. Today with us is Carla Fredericks, who is an enrolled citizen of the Mandan, Hidatsa, and Arikara Nation of North Dakota. She is the CEO of the Christian Sun Fund. She has provided core support for the UN Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. She served as the counsel to the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe in bringing their opposition to the Dakota Access Pipeline. She has assisted the Maya peoples of Southern Belize in implementing the affirmation of their land rights. Our next speaker is Kate Finn. She's the representative of the Osage Nation in the United States. She's the executive director of the First Peoples Worldwide. Her work is to forward corporate responsibility to the rights of Indigenous peoples. Her work also encompasses research and strategies that center Indigenous values in creating sustainable futures for all. Kate has published on issues such as linking financial losses of companies to social conflict generated by the failure to respect human rights. Our next speaker is Tarsila Rivera-Zea, coming from Quechua peoples. For more than 40 years, Tarsila has been defending the rights of Indigenous peoples through the organizations Chirapak and FIMI, where she's the president and founder. She has served as the expert at the United Nations Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues from 2017 to 2019. She's the member of the International Committee for the Futures of Education at UNESCO and Continental Coordinator of the Continental Network of Indigenous Women of the Americas, ECMIA. Our next speaker is the Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, Francisco Cali, who is Maya Kakchikel. He served as the ambassador of Guatemala to the Federal Republic of Germany and was president of the Committee for the Elimination of All Forms of Racial Discrimination. He was the director of human rights at the University of Foreign Affairs of Guatemala. He was the member of the Presidential Commission Against Discrimination and Racism Against Indigenous Peoples in Guatemala and president of the National Reparation Program for Victims of the Internal Armed Conflict. And finally, and most importantly, with us, Dr. Wilton Littlechild, who is the representative of the Cree Nation. He has worked with the United Nations for more than 30 years, advocating for the rights of Aboriginal peoples all over the world. His international work includes the UN Human Rights Council, world conferences and seminars, the UN Permanent Forum on Indigenous Issues, as well as being a representative of the International Organization of Indigenous Resource Development. He is the founding member of the Indigenous Initiative for Peace, the chairperson of the Denver text of the American Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, and a member and vice president for the Indigenous Parliament of the Americas. He is currently a member of the Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples and has served 2 years as chairperson. So it is a great pleasure to be hosting this incredible panel and inviting this panelist to this conversation. So as mentioned in the welcome session throughout the conference, we will be looking at the state of our Indigenous languages from the holistic perspective. This panel is dedicated to one of these multiple angles, which is a legal perspective from the angle of our Indigenous rights. I strongly believe that erosion of our languages leads to the erosion of cultures. And the erosion of cultures leads to the erosion of our landscapes. And that the state of our languages is a reflection of our rights as Indigenous peoples, a barometer and a temperature check of where we are as peoples, as well as the condition of the land that we are on. So let's explore this perspective together with our remarkable panelists. The first question that I'm going to ask to everyone is, how do the overall well-being of Indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages? So I would like to invite Carla to respond to the first question.
Good morning, Galina. Good day, good afternoon, everyone. I'm very happy to be here. I think the core issue around Indigenous language is it's the way that Indigenous peoples have to express themselves in a culturally consistent and self-determined way. And it's also a way that Indigenous peoples understand their cosmology and spiritual systems as peoples. And so, as we think about issues regarding land rights, cultural preservation, self-determination, decision-making, having a competence in Indigenous language, having an understanding of Indigenous language is crucial to be able to activate across the different spectrums of advocacy and activism.
Oh, I put myself on mute. So, Kate, I would like to bring you to answer the question, how do the overall well-being of Indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages?
Absolutely. Good morning, Galina, and good day and good afternoon to you all. I'm so honored to present alongside this panel and to be invited. So thank you very much. I think, Galina, that the need to retain and revitalize our Indigenous languages has become all the more clear in this pandemic. So where our languages, as Carla said, are linked to our culture, our history, and our visions for the future, it becomes all the more important to protect our elders and our children. I myself am Osage. My elders in the early 1900s were sent to boarding school, we began to lose our language. We lost a lot of the native speakers of our language through the 1900s, to the point where today there are only 3 people in the world that are native Osage language speakers. But what I'm happy to report is that because of a real push to revitalize language, there are more than 20 to 50 language speakers who can speak at cultural ceremonies, who can speak at events, and who can ground us and center us in our culture. And that's much more than the language programs, or that's, you know, part of the language programs that the Osage Nation has put together. So I would just say that from where I sit, the importance of language, as Carla had said, is about relationship. It's the way we relate. It's the way we relate to our people, holding our elders and our children sacred. It's the way we relate to our land. It's the way we relate to our natural and built environment. And it's the way that we vision forward. So to me, how we can speak our language is how we can walk into self-determination and walk into advocacy with a full foundation of our priorities and rights to move forward in the future.
Thank you, Kate. I appreciate it. And Darcila, can you please respond to the same question? How do the overall well-being of Indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages?
Para mí, muy agradecida por la invitación junto a hermanas y hermanos maravillosos con gran experiencia y sabiduría. Ukuizun hoy mantaya, jampunapaj, kachun, kunamparlas hanchik, rimas hanchik. Que esta conversación de hoy pueda servir para conocernos mejor y justamente construir esa humanidad indígena que estamos en diversas partes del mundo. El derecho a expresarse en la lengua propia es para mí el derecho fundamental primero. Durante muchos años hemos sido, en realidad, estigmatizadas por no hablar la lengua oficial. Y entonces, con la idea de asimilarnos a una sociedad formal o integrarnos a una sociedad formal, nos han ido arrancando lo más importante, que es el derecho a expresarse en lengua propia. Y de la forma que nosotros y nosotras como pueblos definamos. En ese sentido, me parece que es muy importante reconocer que la lengua viene a ser no solo el idioma, sino que tiene un contenido cultural, o sea, tiene una simbología, ¿no? Cuando decimos estoy hablándote desde mi corazón, no es aquel dibujo rojo, sino aquel sentimiento profundo del cual sale nuestra expresión. Por eso en quechua, el sunju, ukuy sunju y manta rimamuiki, tiene hasta un tono, un cariño, expresa todo. Por eso es tan importante relacionar la lengua con las culturas de los propios pueblos. Y por eso creo yo que es maravillosa esta conversación, porque hay una revitalización frente a la exclusión y al racismo lingüístico también.
Muchas gracias, Germán Tarsila, por su intervención. Thank you so much, Sister Tarsila, for your intervention.
You're on mute.
Can you hear me now? Okay. Don Francisco Cali, your turn to answer this question. How do the overall well-being of indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages?
Sekarchi wonocher, ishokti, atia, ishtani, haraboni, akwala, wonocher. Pri imatisiche, iwinakishu, sikich, wakamin, impe, parihuni, malechmolochre, matios, janiran, matios, ishive. Estimadas y estimados participantes en esta conferencia, reciban mi cálido saludo hasta los distintos lugares en donde se encuentran. Un saludo cordial, muy cordial y especial a Cultural Survival por estar a un año de cumplir sus 50 años de su fundación, medio siglo abogando por los derechos de los pueblos indígenas a la libre determinación, las culturas y la resiliencia política de los pueblos indígenas. Les deseo éxitos en estos 3 días de intensa actividad en las que se privilegia la palabra, el pensamiento y el saber. Felicito enormemente esta oportunidad. Quisiera compartirles que mi intervención se circunscribe a emitir juicios, valoraciones, reflexiones en torno a las preguntas generadoras facilitadas por los organizadores de este evento. Y lo que Galina acaba de preguntar en torno a esta pregunta, partiré reflexionando que nuestras vidas personales, la vida comunitaria o la vida en sociedad en general, en realidad son sistemas. Cada elemento de la vida, de la comunidad y de la sociedad en general representa una pieza clave para que todo funcione a la perfección. Nuestro entorno y la vida es un todo interdependiente como complejo de elementos interactuantes. A partir de lo anterior, concluyo que la limitación de un derecho incide significativamente en el bienestar general de toda persona o sociedad. Los pueblos indígenas tienen derecho a preservar sus propios idiomas, pues estos representan la vida, los conocimientos, la sabiduría, la espiritualidad, la historia, la visión del cosmos, la filosofía y los valores. Desde las lenguas indígenas se educa, se cura, se planifica, se solucionan los conflictos, se comunica con los ancestros, se ofrenda a nuestros antepasados, se transmite el dolor y la alegría. Los idiomas son como pentagramas de conocimientos. Cada idioma es un universo con un sistema y una estructura. Hacer trascender un idioma representa trascender a las personas, las familias, las comunidades y nuestros pueblos.
Muchas gracias, Don Francisco. Thank you so much, Don Francisco, for your response. And finally, Grand Chief Willie Littlechild, how do the overall well-being of indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages? You're muted. Grand Chief?
I'll switch to my phone for a second. We're
hearing echo. Can you hear us? Grand Chief, are you there? As Kaimana mentioned in his welcoming speech, that the technologies are great support for us during this time. But unfortunately, sometimes it's very difficult to use these technologies, and they fail. Well, hopefully that a grand chief little child will connect to Zoom fairly soon, but we can continue with the next question. And as soon as grand chief is back to Zoom, I'll ask the question again. So my first question is to Kate. How are our indigenous languages connected to the implementation of indigenous rights, intellectual property rights, and the free prior informed consent? Kate, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Galina. I think a common thread that I'm hearing today is this idea that with our languages, we're strong. With indigenous languages, we can walk forward with strength, and that the state of indigenous language really does reflect the state of indigenous well-being, as well as the state of implementation of indigenous rights. And so, around my work at First Peoples Worldwide, we work on the implementation of free, prior, and informed consent. And really the purpose of FPIC is to ensure that the priorities of indigenous leaders are not only accounted for, but that they're respected and acted upon. And part of defining those priorities is activating indigenous languages, because where those languages are activated, it goes without saying that that drives the priorities, that drives the relationships and the ways that indigenous leaders can bring forward their knowledge. So where indigenous languages are activated and become the priorities, and then where FPIC is respected, whether it be by states, corporations, or others, that language has created a through line of relationship and definition and strength that can then be elevated into the global discourse and elevated into the priorities and self-determined priorities of Indigenous peoples. So it's that key there, where there is FPIC, then we can find a voice, find a way for those priorities and those indigenous languages to come forward. It's also on the other end of the spectrum, a way to protect indigenous language. It's a way to protect education, a way to ensure that through line of language is kept for our children and maintained, so that traditional knowledge and that wisdom can be held in the communities, and not just held, but shaped and used to shape what it is that the visions are for the future. And so I think that, the way that the relationships are articulated is the most important part, and a reflection of the state of not only the protection of education, the protection of human rights on the ground, but how human rights are allowing priorities to be forwarded. And as others have said, of course, Indigenous wisdom, Indigenous knowledge is founded in language. So it connects, again, not only to protections through the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, but also efforts through WIPO and other organizations to protect the language and the symbols, arts, and culture. I know that in data that was prepared in 2019, at least 40% of the estimated 6,000 languages spoken around the world were endangered. And there were political and social isolation and lots of reasons about that. And only a few hundred spoken languages have an established place in the world's education systems. So once again, where human rights can be protected, where our rights to education and culture can be protected, and where those can be amplified through education, that's where language can be a place and a hub of growing knowledge, keeping knowledge, growing knowledge, and then building that into the self-determined priorities of Indigenous leaders around the world. And when that occurs, those are the moments of strength that I believe reflect the best articulation of human rights of Indigenous peoples.
Thank you, Kate. And can you a little bit kind of delve into what AFPIC is? Can you help us understand AFPIC and its principles a little bit more in the context of this response?
Absolutely. So when we're talking about free, prior, and informed consent as to Indigenous peoples, we're talking about the mechanism by which Indigenous peoples can articulate their rights to outside entities and forward their priorities. And so what I think that this connects to languages is that where Indigenous peoples can articulate their priorities in their own way, through their own customary practices, through their own governance, through their own mechanisms and in their own languages, then through AFPIC, when AFPIC is respected by states and corporations, those priorities become part of the global discourse, whether that discourse is about climate change and how Indigenous knowledge can help to solve for some of the global challenges that we will all face due to climate change, whether it is articulating very specific priorities about a particular impact of development in that particular community. Whatever it is, AFPIC is a gateway. It's a way for Indigenous leaders to be on the same, at the same table and having the same conversation and really driving the conversation about the impacts of development in their community.
Thank you. Thank you, Kate. My next question is for Tarsila. From your experience as an Indigenous rights activist, which Indigenous people's rights are most related to languages? Access to justice systems in Indigenous languages or rights to have bilingual education and how they have been implemented? And what's your take on Indigenous languages from a gender perspective?
Gracias, Galina. Yo voy a seguir en la ruta del hermano Cali, inspirándonos en nuestras propias culturas y lenguas. Y tendríamos que decir que ya varias generaciones de liderazgos indígenas hemos ejercido el derecho a la libre determinación de participar en escenarios que no era usual que estemos, pero nos hemos metido. Y creo que el primero que yo quiero comentar con ustedes es ese espacio de las Naciones Unidas en Ginebra, a donde el hermano Pancho no me puede hacer referencias, donde se discutían, por ejemplo, los primeros párrafos de la Declaración de Derechos sobre Pueblos Indígenas en inglés, sin interpretación. Imagínense ustedes, yo llegué el año 87, todos mis hermanos sentados escuchando a don Miguel Alfonso hablando en inglés, preparando, ¿no? Yo decía, pero bueno, ¿cómo vamos a participar si no entendemos? Y las hermanas indígenas del norte, principalmente de Canadá, se enteraron que necesitamos interpretación porque nosotros no hablábamos el inglés. Entonces, ¿cómo hacernos entender en un idioma que no conocíamos para transmitir derechos desde nuestra concepción? Imagínense ese primer desafío. El segundo desafío se da en los sistemas formales de educación en nuestros estados, ¿no? Primero empezaron los lingüistas a querer recuperar, registrar las lenguas indígenas y la Biblia de la Iglesia Católica, ya en el 1530 tenía traducción a los idiomas indígenas usando los conceptos nuestros para catequizarnos. Entonces, el idioma sí se convirtió en una herramienta también de colonización, ¿no? y de evangelización cuando los de afuera entendieron en qué consistía nuestra lengua y el significado que tenía en nuestra filosofía, en nuestra cosmovisión y en nuestra relación con el mundo. Entonces yo puedo referir, por ejemplo, con el idioma quechua chanca, que es de donde yo vengo, cuando empiezan a hablarnos del hanampacha, caipacha, ucupacha, simplemente nos están diciendo el cielo, la tierra y el infierno. Pero para nosotros, ¿qué significaba el ucupacha? El ucupacha, por ejemplo, donde moran los dioses de la montaña que no son visibles, ¿no? Y lo mismo pensaba yo cuando íbamos hablando de lo que significa desde nuestra lengua, y seguro en la lengua del hermano Cali o de cualquiera de ustedes, ¿qué significa la madre tierra, la Pachamama para nosotros? Mother Earth para los de allá. Pero como la cultura y la filosofía y la cosmovisión define el significado, es que para nosotros la Pachamama tiene un significado de vida, de energía, de salud, ¿no? De relación armónica, donde la reciprocidad es importante. Nos dan, nos protegen, nos dan la vida, nos dan la alimentación, nos dan la salud, y nosotros tratamos de la misma manera a la madre tierra. Pero desde otra cultura, ¿cómo se ve a la madre tierra? Y si hablamos en contextos actuales, cada cual está percibiendo de una manera diferente. Por eso el derecho a la libre determinación en relación al uso de la lengua y la cultura propia viene a ser determinante. Pero creo que estamos avanzando a raíz justamente del reconocimiento en derechos que generalmente viene desde el escenario internacional donde el mundo indígena participa, porque hay mucha resistencia en nuestros países por el tema del racismo y la discriminación. Antiguamente se hablaba de la educación vertical, solo en el idioma oficial. Progresivamente se empezó a hablar de la educación bilingüe, ¿no? Como una transcripción de algo en la propia lengua, y solo para indígenas. Luego viene la educación bilingüe intercultural, y hoy estamos pidiendo educación intercultural como sistema nacional, donde todas las lenguas y todas las culturas en la diversidad de estados pluriculturales y multilingües tengan el mismo nivel de respeto que cualquier otra lengua oficial o no. Entonces, sí creemos que estamos avanzando, pero es un esfuerzo de generaciones y ahí entran los juristas indígenas también para elaborar estos párrafos en los documentos y que nos sirven de herramienta para incidir en las políticas de los estados y garantizar que nuestras lenguas vayan acordes con el derecho de pervivir como culturas, lenguas y culturas, que encierra todo un contexto que hoy, cuando hablamos del cambio climático, vemos hace que teníamos razón y tenemos razón para garantizar la vida de la naturaleza y con ella nosotros como seres humanos. Porque hace 40 años, cuando nosotros hablábamos de nuestra relación con la madre naturaleza, no nos creían, se burlaban de nosotros, pero hoy estamos en esta misma relación de hacer entender cómo esta filosofía de vida transmitida a través de las lenguas que encierran conceptos maravillosos, garantizan la vida no solo nuestra, de los indígenas, sino también de la humanidad. O sea, ese es el contenido que nos gustaría que se transmita en los sistemas educativos públicos, ¿no? De los financiados por los estados al que accede el pueblo. Con eso creo que es suficiente. Y tenemos un horizonte largo por el diseño de las lenguas. O sea, lo que sí tenemos que es cuidar que justamente no se hable solo de la lengua como un idioma, sino lengua y cultura para que pervivamos como seres humanos que producimos cultura. Porque la dimensión más amplia de los derechos tiene que ir en forma integral como lo dice nuestra filosofía indígena en cualquier parte del mundo, ¿no? Creo que el futuro también tiene que poner en evidencia que las expresiones culturales diversas y las expresiones lingüísticas es un derecho al que la nueva generación tiene. Y por lo tanto, cuando se institucionalice la enseñanza en los colegios, en las universidades, ¿no? La nueva generación que ya no está bebiendo de la historia o el conocimiento desde las abuelas y los abuelos, va a poder continuar con este legado que para nosotros es la vida de nuestras lenguas, pero también de nuestras culturas.
Thank you, dear Tarsila. What a beautiful response. I see that Grant Chief Willie Little Child is back to our panel. Maybe I can ask the first question that you were not able due to the technical issues to respond. Are you there? I have to unmute yourself. Oh, there you go. So I'm going to ask the first question. How do the overall well-being of Indigenous peoples and the full exercise of our rights connect to our languages? The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Nigan gakio ketam skarnao. Meikat mohteoni and sigasan. Thank you very much for this opportunity finally to be able to link with you. It's a very important question, and I'm going to relate it to nationhood or sovereignty. Because one of the fundamental questions that are asked of states when they want to join the United Nations, for example, as a nation, to express that they have sovereignty, one of the questions there are asked is, do you have your own language? And that's a very fundamentally important barrier for us if it's going to be a situation where our languages keep decreasing or our languages keep disappearing or dying. So language is a very fundamental element to sovereignty. And I'll say inclusive of it, or a part of it, I guess, would be the cultural element. Sometimes culture is wrapped into, or language is wrapped into the general topic of culture. And when you do that, you lose the essence of our language, which is the spiritual aspect. Now, the other important elements, of course, are government, our lands, territories, and resources as inherent rights become increasingly more difficult to explain or describe to other nation states who are going to be making decisions that impact us if we don't have the strength of our language behind our interventions. So it's very fundamentally linked, I think, to nationhood as a direct element of sovereignty. And I didn't catch your second question, I'm sorry.
That was the question. And I will have your the second question following Don Francisco Cali's intervention. So I'll come back to that second question. Thank you so much for your response. So my next question is to Don Francisco. As the Special Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, what recommendations would you give to policymakers, academics, governments, philanthropic institutions, civil society, in order to better support collective actions towards advancing Indigenous people's rights in general and right to our cultures and languages specifically?
Bueno, hay muchas cuestiones que se podrían decir esencialmente en ese sentido. Sin embargo, si tomamos en cuenta lo estipulado por el artículo 8 de la Declaración de las Naciones Unidas sobre los Derechos de los Pueblos Indígenas, que establece esencialmente que los pueblos y los individuos indígenas tienen derecho a no ser sometidos a ninguna asimilación forzada ni a la destrucción de su cultura, creo que la protección y recuperación de los idiomas indígenas es fundamental para evitar de tener inclusive poder implementar la reparación de los procesos de asimilación que sufrieron los pueblos indígenas. Desafortunadamente, como indica la UNESCO, al menos el 40% de las 7,000 o de los 7,000 idiomas indígenas utilizados en todo el mundo están en algún nivel de peligro. En ese sentido, creo de que es necesario de una u otra forma identificar las recomendaciones para promover los derechos de los pueblos indígenas en general y el derecho a su cultura y sus idiomas específicamente. Me gustaría recordar los artículos 18 y 19 de la Declaración sobre los Derechos de los Pueblos Indígenas, que reconocen los derechos de los pueblos indígenas a participar en la adopción de decisiones que afecten a sus derechos a ser consultados sobre iniciativas y obtener el consentimiento previo, libre e informado en caso de cualquier iniciativa que vayan a afectar sus derechos. Creo que estos principios deben y son los que deben de guiar la adopción y promoción de proyectos dirigidos a la tutela, a la protección de los idiomas indígenas. Es importante que las organizaciones o los legisladores y los otros actores desarrollen proyectos con la participación plena de los pueblos indígenas, tomando en cuenta sus necesidades, sus peticiones y en particular apoyando las iniciativas que las comunidades de los pueblos indígenas están desarrollando de forma independiente. Creo que hay muchas áreas que podrían ser recomendación a los legisladores y a los políticos de las diferentes naciones, pero creo que lo fundamental sería eso, pues, esencialmente, respetar el derecho que tienen los pueblos indígenas a ser consultados antes de cualquier iniciativa y de cualquier lanzamiento de proyectos que vayan a afectar negativa o positivamente a sus derechos.
Thank you, Don Francisco Cali. I have a question for Carla Fredericks. So Carla, can you share your experiences working in the field on the front lines as well as from a philanthropic perspective? What needs to be done in order to support the revitalization of indigenous languages?
Yes, I just want to say that this is such a rich conversation and really represents the incredible leadership of the Indigenous peoples, not only on this panel, who are all incredible, but also the communities themselves who have really I think, set the agenda around the set of issues. And as I've been thinking about the comments that have been made today, it strikes me that what we really have to start thinking about is colonialism as not a thing of the past, but something that's living on very much like a virus, actually, in existing systems and structures, including philanthropy. Some mention has been made of the history of Indian boarding schools in the US and Canada. For those of you who are unaware, in the late 19th century and well into the 20th, governments forcibly separated tens of thousands of Indian children from their families and communities and sent them off to schools where their education included being stripped of their cultural identity. And in this context, children were, of course, not allowed to use or be called by their own names or speak their native languages. And this philosophy, as the founder of the first off-reservation boarding school put it, was to kill the Indian and save the man. And this is something, as Chief Littlechild said, that really permeated policy processes as well. So there's a psychic, social, and cultural trauma that has been was experienced by Native children and continues to be experienced in Native communities in these often brutal environments. And it was compounded by terrible conditions, malnutrition, forced labor, other forms of physical abuse, and the death of Indigenous children that went unmarked and unaddressed and is really only being addressed now. So at its heart, colonialism is about white supremacy. And all institutions and systems in the US, even the most well-intentioned, have been distorted by this legacy, including the very existence of philanthropic institutions, which are a result of wealth accumulation. So ultimately, the goal of colonization is wealth accumulation. And in colonized societies, that wealth is created by centuries of genocidal policies, land confiscation, slavery, discriminatory laws and practices, and denying communities access to white-controlled sources of wealth. But philanthropy also really demonstrates that if the love of money is the root of all evil, money itself is neither good nor evil. So it can really be used at this point to help facilitate healing from trauma and restoring harmony to a world that's very much out of balance. So today I wanted to bring four recommendations for how philanthropy can work to heal and work to decolonize and to support Indigenous peoples, including, of course, this very important consideration of language revitalization. So first, philanthropy has to move money to where trauma is deepest, which is, of course, directly to Indigenous communities. As others have mentioned, the language and educational programs in communities are exceptional efforts and they need support. And if we understand language and an intergenerational approach as fundamental rights of Indigenous peoples, funding language should be part of and not separate from other funding efforts that philanthropy makes for Indigenous communities. Second, trauma is something that can only be known by those who have actually experienced it. So one thing we have to consider is what it would look like if our philanthropic staff and boards were comprised of individuals from the communities we serve. Third, we're also seeing in philanthropy and practicing the emergence of participatory grant making and trying to democratize our institutional decision making. This is a pretty nascent practice in philanthropy, but it does need leadership, and it's something that the Christensen Fund is very interested in participating in and leading. And fourth, our foundation's investment strategies, any foundation's investment strategy, can't be divorced from its mission. So institutional philanthropy can't expect to drive meaningful change when only 5% of its assets that it accumulated through colonization is allocated to grant making, while the other 95% is invested in pursuit of financial return. Often that financial return is in the very companies that are creating the social and environmental problems that foundations are trying to address. So here at the Christensen Fund, we are beginning to take steps to use our endowment corpus more intentionally as a means of generating greater social impact for Indigenous peoples. And I guess lastly, I just want to say that the restoration of language is part of a healing and decolonization process. And it also, I think, is a key lever toward reconciliation. So as Indigenous peoples, we of course believe that everything is connected and interrelated. And I think that this set of considerations that are being discussed today and in this conference really represents a unique opportunity to heal, protect, and restore each other and the planet we share. So very grateful for this conference and for cultural survival for being attentive to these issues.
Thank you, Carla. Thank you so much. And now back to Dr. Wilton Littlechild. The question for you is, what would be some important actions to strengthen the language revitalization work in the context of the upcoming decade of Indigenous languages? From your point of view, what would be some recommendations at the UN level?
Well, if I may, before I answer that, I wanted to comment both on the rapporteurs and Carla's interventions just now, because I think they're important to consider an additional element, for example, to Special Rapporteur's commentary, the United Nations Declaration, specifically Articles 8 and 19, but to which I would add Articles 23 and 32, because those are essential also in terms of the requirement for free, prior, and informed consent as it relates especially to development. And secondly, I agree with Carla's first point about where the money should be going first in terms of where the need is the greatest. And it reminded me of our Truth Commission when we were working on it. One of the first conclusions very early on as a test report was to declare that the residential school or the boarding school policy of both Canada and United States, there was a direct assault on Indigenous languages, families, communities, and our cultures. So one wonders, like I did, how much money was spent in trying to kill our languages through the residential school system or the boarding school system? Because I think you can actually determine that amount of records if we can have access to it, if they've not been destroyed, as in some cases, shredded or burned. But to determine how much exactly was spent in trying to kill our languages. And then you have a measurement to gauge the granting or the philanthropy in terms of dedication of resources to where it's most needed. And thirdly, your question. Now I got off track. Your question was again, what?
One second. The question was, what would be some important actions to strengthen the language revitalization in the context of the upcoming decade on Indigenous languages? And from your point of view, what would be these recommendations at the UN level?
Well, I think at the current work that's going on designing a global action plan for the decade, one of the essential elements is to bring our languages home. And let me explain that by saying we have a responsibility as Indigenous peoples to speak our own languages in our own homes, because that's where the strength of revitalization begins. And if we don't do that, then it'll be a longer process. For example, we will have to begin using our own school authorities or our own school systems or our curricula redesigning to include Indigenous languages to be taught in the schools. I'll give you a practical example of my own community where a residential school existed for since 1874 to 1975. And it almost decimated our language. We were down to 9% of us are fluent today. I'm sorry, about 3 years ago. When we took over our school authorities and we made it mandatory that language, Cree language, be taught in the schools, we've gone up to 15% already in 3 years. So I think the role of us as families with our own responsibility to teach the mother tongue and speak it at home, and secondarily, if not possible, then to introduce it in the schools where the children can begin at a young age to learn the language again, will revitalize. And that foundation, I would certainly consider, from my perspective anyway, to be very important, and to use it in all places. And by that, I mean, for example, with regard to access to justice, many, many, many of our brothers and sisters, unfortunately, have ended up in prison simply because they didn't know or understand the language that was being used in the court. And if we begin to use our own languages in the court systems, in the justice system, with interpreters initially, but I find that the strength of our cases many times is the strength of our language. And the classic example is treaties. Treaties have been tested in courts only in English. And of course, that's only half of the story. To really understand the true meaning of a treaty as a sacred agreement between indigenous peoples, tribes, and nations, and with the crown in our case, you have to understand that it's passed on through oral testimony in our nation. So if you don't understand the language, either English or your own, then you're really in serious jeopardy for any kind of access to justice. So using it in academia, I think, and using it at home are considerations for recommendations during the decade, I think, that could be considered.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Little Child. These are very important considerations. I just wanted to reiterate the importance of creating the Global Action Plan, bringing indigenous languages home, increasing the numbers of speakers at home, having access to justice, use of our native languages in the justice system. These are all incredible recommendations. And I wanted to ask other speakers, what recommendations do you have, both on the global level, UN level, also country, community level? What needs to happen in order to protect and revitalize our languages, in order to increase the number of speakers in our communities? So maybe Kate, you can respond to this question.
I would be happy to. I have to say that I am, as a mother of young children, you know, it strikes me when Grand Chief Little Child, when you speak, and Miss Tarsila Rivera, I am. It really is a first right that I have to speak with my child and to say I love you, and to her have say the same back to me in our language. And that moment of transmitting knowledge and that moment of teaching and being in our home and exchanging is the beginning of all of it, right? And so I think as we think about these recommendations on the global level at the UN, you know, it really is about that through line of preserving language in the home, creating supports through education that bolster and respect and create a space for Indigenous languages to be recognized on equal par with any other language in the nation state. And then to really be able to build that into advocacy, to build up Indigenous peoples as advocates that can carry the relationships, translate the relationships built into languages into other languages. And with, I think the North Star is for us to be able to advocate in our own languages, in our own courts, and to say our own priorities out loud and visibly and respected in our own languages. So I think the recommendations are really a through line that create and hold and expand the space for advocates all the way from the home to the education system into these broader systems of law and policy at the larger level as well.
Thank you, Kate. And the same question, absolutely. Dr. Littlechild, you can unmute yourself. You wanted to respond to Kate.
I'm sorry. If I may add a very, very critically important point that was just made. One of the most damaging impacts on us as Indigenous peoples through the residential school or boarding school policy in forbidding us from speaking our language was the not only the language, but the emotion, the parental separation from the child that severed the not only the ability to speak the language, but the very critically, and only a mother could say this the best about love. Love was also very, very seriously impacted in some places actually torn apart. I'll give you my own personal example. I didn't know what love is when I came out of school. And I spent 14 years in three different residential schools. And love was not something you learned. Parenting was not something you learned. You learned punishment. So many parents language because they were afraid their children were going to be punished. And it was only when the strength of one mother spoke up in our public hearings of over 7,000 witnesses, when she said, I can get up in the morning now and look at myself and say, I love you. Then I could turn to my spouse or my partner, I love you. My children or grandchildren, it grows in a sense as to strength the power of being able to say, I love you. Equally the power to forgive or to accept an apology. But more importantly, I think when a mother can say, Kisa agihtin, first thing in the morning, Kisa agihtin, I love myself. I think those are really very, very, very important from a mental health perspective and from self-identity and self-esteem perspective. So I want to thank, I think it was Kate that was speaking before, I didn't see.
Yes, that was Kate. Yes.
So thank you for that, Kate, because that's so critically important in terms of going forward. formulate our global action plan so that we can revitalize not only our language, but the emotion, mental health aspects of our own language. Thank you, and I'm sorry to interject like this.
No, that's beautiful. That was so beautiful. And Bayerla, thank you for this intervention. Like, it really brings it home for us. Why is it important? Because at the heart of it is love, right? So that's life is all about. It's about love and family and being able to communicate that love in the language that we know. In my native language, when I speak and hear it, I access a different state of mind. You know, it's like medicine to me. When I hear it, I feel it like flowing in my blood, in my body. It makes me happy. And I'm sure there are some processes in my body, in my brain, the citizen level, the dopamine level all rise when we speak our languages. It's true medicine.
Some people have said, in fact, I'm sorry to do this again. some people have, in fact, said that when we were talking about trauma earlier, it's medicine. It's actually a treatment to be able to speak your language or learn your language again. It's actually a treatment and medicine for us to be able to do that.
Thank you for that. Don Francisco Cali, I want to invite you to answer the same questions. What are the recommendations from your standpoint on community level, regional, country level, international level? What needs to happen in the next decade for us to revitalize our languages? You are muted, Don Francisco. Okay.
Bueno, después de escuchar a Kate y al gran jefe Willie Littlechild, es muy difícil poder decir muchas cosas más con respecto a qué es lo que se tiene que hacer. Sin embargo, yo creo de que una de las cosas que se pueden recomendar es que se respeten los sistemas y los mecanismos propios de los pueblos indígenas. Inclusive que haya garantía de retorno de esos conocimientos indígenas documentados por parte de cooperantes, académicos, entre otros, y que todas las publicaciones cuenten con la anuencia de los portadores de estos saberes. En el caso de los estudios, la documentación o sistematización que se realicen en territorio de los pueblos indígenas se implementen como una responsabilidad ética que de los mismos cientistas sociales no publiquen este trabajo sin antes de una forma previa sea presentado ante los pueblos indígenas, que han sido los que han aportado ese conocimiento científico que se está planteando en un libro. También superar la mala práctica de las políticas de homogenización de las sociedades y la práctica de la mayoría de los estados de contar con lenguas oficiales únicas. En tal sentido, yo invitaría a los estados para que honren sus compromisos internacionales en materia de derechos humanos en general y en derechos de los pueblos indígenas, primero basándose en la buena fe y la observancia de los tratados que de manera soberana se han comprometido a cumplir. Y entre estas el diseño internacional de las lenguas indígenas aprobada en la resolución A/74/396 de la Asamblea General de las Naciones Unidas, que representa una oportunidad histórica que no debe esperar más tiempo para que se tomen las medidas de conservación, revitalización y promoción de los idiomas indígenas. si tomamos en cuenta lo que ha dicho la UNESCO de que un idioma desaparece cada dos semanas, es algo terrible. Porque sabemos que cuando se muere un idioma, no solo el idioma se está muriendo, se está muriendo todo lo que Willy nos ha transmitido el día de hoy, lo que Kate nos estaba transmitiendo el día de hoy, ese acúmulo de conocimientos científicos, de conocimientos de relación con la madre naturaleza, todo eso se está perdiendo. Se está perdiendo un legado de conocimiento que nunca más los vamos a tener. Entonces yo creo que es importante que los estados, inclusive desde las mismas bases de las comunidades, de los pueblos indígenas, hasta el nivel de Naciones Unidas, se comprometan a que van a revitalizar, van a recuperar, van a fortalecer los idiomas de los pueblos indígenas.
Muchas gracias, don Francisco. Doña Tarsila, I'm asking you to take the floor to answer the same questions regarding the recommendations.
Recomendaciones, creo que hay muchas. Lo que hace falta es implementarlas y que nosotros como pueblos indígenas estemos vigilantes y activos para que se conviertan en políticas públicas dentro de los países. Eso es importante. Porque el derecho a la lengua tiene que ver, sí, con los derechos lingüísticos, pero también es un derecho cultural y es un derecho humano fundamental y es un derecho político. O sea, nuestras lenguas tienen el derecho de estar en todo el sistema donde se ejerce la vida política del país, como lo acaba de explicar el jefe Willy Littlechild. En los juicios, por ejemplo, ¿por qué si yo soy quechua o mohawk no se me va a ejercer una justicia en la propia lengua de la que yo soy parte? Porque hasta ahora no pasa aquello, ¿no? Entonces, creo que tenemos que luchar principalmente contra las políticas integracionistas y asimilacionistas que también están relacionados con las formas neocoloniales de apropiación de nuestros conocimientos mal uso de la propia lengua. Porque ahora, como pedimos que los documentos estén en lengua indígena, cualquier político usa nuestra lengua para hacer campaña proselitista a su beneficio. Entonces tenemos que estar muy vigilantes de cómo se usan las lenguas. En el foro permanente se tienen, por ejemplo, relacionando conocimientos de mujeres indígenas, conocimiento de los pueblos indígenas, lengua y educación. Yo creo que tenemos alrededor de 500 recomendaciones hacia el sistema de las Naciones Unidas y hacia los estados. Entonces, queda enterarse. Por ejemplo, una comparación entre las recomendaciones que salen de la Relatoría de Derechos de Pueblos Indígenas, la de la UNESCO, relacionado con educación y cultura, del mecanismo de expertos, de otro, y del mismo foro permanente. ¿Cuántas recomendaciones existen? No tenemos un documento unificado. Tenemos que buscar información. Entonces, me parece importante que la filantropía también vea la inversión en conocimientos y en fortalecimiento de los aportes culturales y lingüísticos de los pueblos originarios. Porque la mayoría de fondos siempre están queriendo destinar a proyectos productivos, no siempre a lo cultural. Por ejemplo, hay propuestas de revitalización, de recuperación y de promoción de las lenguas indígenas con conocimientos propios para que pueda entrar en el sistema educativo formal. Y nadie financia ese tipo de propuestas, porque dice, pero eso es cultural, eso es cultural. Unos dicen, no, no tiene importancia, pero como culturas para nosotros es importante y necesita una intervención multidisciplinaria, ¿no? Que es importante. Hermanas y hermanos, lo que aquí debe quedar claro es que la hegemonía de una sola lengua, de una sola cultura en los países donde estamos presentes tiene que ser erradicado. Y tenemos que tener claridad acerca del racismo que hay en nuestros países y también en el sistema de gobierno de los países, donde todo es vertical, un solo idioma, un solo código del derecho romano o el derecho no sé qué, no entra otras formas de ejercicio y de gobernanza y de ver el mundo, de relacionarnos. Por ejemplo, mucho hablamos del sistema educativo. Yo hace poco estuve en el Comité Internacional de Futuros de la Educación de la UNESCO y discutimos mucho, tratamos de incluir lo nuestro. Y yo pedía, ¿cómo hacemos que la educación formal desde los estados sea dignificante para los niños indígenas? ¿Por qué? Porque en los sistemas formales, donde se hace todo desde una oficialidad lingüística, el niño termina con la autoestima dañada, con su emocionalidad dañada, con vergüenza de su propia cultura, de su rostro, de su lengua. Entonces, ¿cómo vamos a tener ciudadanas y ciudadanos plenos cuando el sitio a donde accede para formarse y ser mejor no se conoce su historia, no se valida su lengua, no se valoran sus conocimientos, no se tiene respeto por sus ancestros? O sea, todo eso tiene que cambiar y nosotros como activistas, pero ustedes también dedicados a la filantropía, tenemos que invertir en esto siempre con esa mirada del respeto a los derechos humanos fundamentales, porque es fundamental ser respetado y ejercer tu derecho como especificidad cultural, como especificidad lingüística. Y entonces el decenio, como menciona hermano Cali, nos da un horizonte, pero no vaya a ser como el decenio de los pueblos indígenas, que todo eso se discute cada año en Nueva York, pero nuestros estados ni lo conocen. Es ese desafío que tenemos de trabajar dentro de nuestros países. Y toca dos. Uno es hacia los de afuera. Hay que romper su ignorancia sobre nuestros aportes y tenemos que nosotros internamente fortalecernos con propuestas y tener esa estrategia de lograr que se reconozca desde lo público, desde lo formal, no solo en el espacio privado. En el espacio privado podemos usar nuestra lengua y nuestra cultura, pero yo soy de la idea que ya no podemos ser marginales. Tenemos que ser ciudadanas y ciudadanos plenos, con libertad y con decisión propia, dónde estar y cómo vivir, no solo reducidos a un espacio y que en el otro espacio público no somos visibles, no somos valorados y no somos legitimados. O sea, esa es mi, más o menos mi forma de pensar, y el racismo como ideología tenemos que desterrarlo porque se expresa en todo lo que tiene que ver con las discriminaciones y las exclusiones. Que aquí tenemos el experto que estuvo en el CER del hermano Francisco, de quien aprendimos mucho para aplicarlo en el escenario de los derechos de los pueblos indígenas, para no ser objeto de racismo ni de ninguna forma de discriminación. Gracias por todo esta, por toda esta oportunidad de escucharles, de aprender también mucho de ustedes.
Muchas gracias, Doña Tarsila. Thank you so much for your response. And Carla, I would like to ask you the same questions, question regarding the recommendations.
So thank you. This is such a powerful conversation, and I laid out some recommendations specific to philanthropy earlier. I think that what I'm hearing from everyone is that this is really healing work, in addition to being all of the other types of work that it is. It's really about supporting healing. And to pick up on what Tarsila just said about racism, I'm struck by something that Fawn Sharp, the president of National Congress of American Indians, said to me when we were opposing the Washington football team name. She talked to me about how the racism that we experience as Indigenous people is not just harmful for us as Indigenous people, but that it's harmful for everyone. It's harmful for the broader society and for all of the children that grow up and think that that's acceptable and that that's an appropriate way to view the world. And right now, I'm thinking a lot about that very issue in the environmental justice and climate space as we are heading toward the COP meeting in at the end of the month and in November. And it occurs to me that every single person here has expressed that language is our expression of our relationships, including our relationship to land and Mother Earth, and that support for the self-determined priorities of Indigenous peoples, whether that be something that can be categorized in a specific way, you know, along the lines of whatever the philanthropic strategy is or not, is crucially important, because we need to recognize that Indigenous peoples have incredible strategic and intersectional approaches of their own. And that it's really an intersectional approach that's going to honor the self-determined priorities of Indigenous people and Indigenous communities. And, you know, it seems to me like there's this paradigm leading up to the COP, and this has happened before in this context, that Indigenous people's stewardship or knowledge is going to save us all from climate disaster. And I think that there's truth in that, but I also think that there's a real risk of an extractive approach in by philanthropy and others in how funding and collaboration with Indigenous peoples take shape. And I feel like this conversation around language is a really interesting one to really test. Are these funders, is the environmental movement interested in being in real relationship with Indigenous peoples on our own terms? Are they willing to accept our approach to what we need to do to effectuate the change and to decolonize our systems? So I just want to offer that as we're kind of looking toward these other meetings, because I do think that it is quite connected. And it's not just a language issue. I mean, I think it's very clear from this panel, this is an everything issue. And that's how we think about things intersectionally and multidimensionally. That's the indigenous that we all share. So thank you.
I love that, indigenous. What a beautiful word. Yes, and exactly the point that we're looking at the language from the holistic perspective, because the languages are a reflection of our rights, because our languages are connected to our lands and livelihoods. You know, the silhouettes of our landscapes are reflected in the sounds in our language. The bird, the singing of the birds, the dancing are all interconnected with our languages, you know. So, and I heard from Dr. Littlechild about the Global Action Plan. So I would like to bring this point as a final point of our conversation today. So what does that mean? How do we proceed from here? What needs to be done in order to first create this global action plan? And secondly, implement this global action plan? So maybe I could invite Dr. Littlechild to kind of give us a quick overview, and you know, so that could be a starter for the remainder of the conversation.
I'm going to go back to a little strategy discussion we had many years ago on the decade for Indigenous peoples. When that was finally accepted as a recommendation from Indigenous Caucus that the UN declare a decade on Indigenous peoples or for Indigenous peoples, we went together as an Indigenous caucus or group and mapped out a decade plan from our lens, we see it. How do we see a decade plan for Indigenous peoples? What are the priorities and how do we achieve those priorities? In other words, we laid out a plan on how the key priorities can be accomplished, at least partially, if not fully, in a decade plan. Decade plans are very short, as you know. For example, on racism, I gave the first keynote address on a decade against racism. And now we're on our fourth decade. In other words, we've been working on it for 40 years now. So even the decade on Indigenous peoples was held as two decades. So, but the key, I thought, to success of us as Indigenous peoples or tribes or nations was that we drafted it ourselves. We sat down and said, this is the global action plan for the revitalization, protection, and maintenance of our language from our perspective. And then we took that, in this instance, it'll be to UNESCO. We can't wait for state members of UNESCO or UNESCO itself to shape a decade plan. We need to shape it ourselves, because what happened with the first one is the UN actually adopted the decade plan that we drafted. So it was Indigenous right from at the outset. It was Indigenous thinking, what we thought were priorities for Indigenous peoples, and presented that to the UN, and they adopted it. I think likewise, it's potentially possible to do the same thing with UNESCO, that we propose a decade plan ourselves and present that as the one that they should adopt. I remember the declaration was the reverse. We went in there with our own UN Declaration on Rights of Indigenous Peoples that we had drafted, but it was rejected. But as the years grew, in terms of the length of time it took, we actually did put back in our original thoughts, at least, of what should be in the decade. We didn't accomplish everything, of course, and it's not perfect, but we got at least 85% of what we needed to be in there. Likewise, in the ILO Convention, the OAS Declaration, we need to take the initiative ourselves. And thank you for organizing this discussion, because that's how we started. And we have the solutions. It has to be a solution-based approach. And we can present our global action plan that way for our brothers and sisters to consider going forward. And if I may close with one comment I was going to use in the illustration, because a special rapporteur, a brother, His Excellency Francisco Cali mentioned the word treaty. In our instance, there are four elements to treaty. There's the written text, which the courts always use, the lawyers used to argue. But what's ignored is the oral testimony, the oral understanding of treaty. Ceremony, the spiritual ceremony that accompanies what the treaty means, and also the songs that go with the treaty story. Those are the best illustrations because they're done through our language. And that's where our language, is our strength. But I think we need to be ourselves of the Global Action Plan. Then I think it'll have a chance to not only be adopted, but to survive and actually have the impact. Our sister Tarsila said the key to all of this is implementation. And in fact, one time I proposed we have a decade of implementation of all the things we had been discussing. We had on the floor at one time, I was a rapporteur, and I had said to the last speaker, I want to thank the last speaker because that's the 3,000th recommendation we've heard during the sessions of the UN Permanent Forum started. But what we need is the key word, implementation. So recently, we were successful in Canada to adopt a legislation on implementation of the UN Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. But we co-drafted that initially ourselves and then in collaboration with state members. We have to have the pen in hand ourselves or pencil, whatever, to begin with. And then we've learned going the other way wasn't successful enough, if it was successful at all. The most successful I've seen to date, and I've been now at this for 43 years, was when we have the pen in hand, we write down what is should be in the Global Action Plan and present that to the UNESCO for adoption. It would be recommendation, and a big part of that has to include how do we implement the Global Action Plan.
Thank you, Dr. Littlechild. This is such a great recommendation. I'd like to follow up with Don Francisco Cali, His Excellency, regarding the Global Action Plan and how the Office of the Special Rapporteur will support the movement and the development, or at least, just wanted to ask you, Don Francisco, like, what are you planning? What are your plans with the Global Action Plan? You're muted.
Ya, muchas gracias. Le agradezco bastante. Esencialmente creo que dentro de los planes de trabajo, por todo lo que hay en este momento, solo puedo decir de que los idiomas indígenas es un tema, llamémosle transversal en todos los estudios que estoy planificando hacer, y como ustedes lo vieron, lo han podido ver en mis dos informes sobre el COVID, he mencionado sobre las problemáticas que tienen. De todas formas, creo de que los derechos humanos son interdependientes y creo que en tal sentido todos los derechos están conectados unos a otros. En el momento en que el plan general vaya a ser discutido y vaya a ser adoptado, creo que la relatoría tiene una obligación de darle seguimiento y implícito también. No es una cuestión de que si yo voy a entrar o no voy a entrar dentro de la discusión. Este está dentro del mandato, estar involucrado en todas las discusiones en las cuales se hable sobre los derechos de los pueblos indígenas. Yo creo que eso no solamente está entre el mandato, sino que es una responsabilidad y una obligación, especialmente por el hecho de que está siendo en esta pandemia que se ha convertido en un negocio, especialmente para las farmacéuticas, por el acceso a las vacunas hacia los pueblos indígenas. Creo que es necesario ver de que los idiomas son importantes para acceder a la información, y creo que esta pandemia lo que hace es esencialmente obligarnos a entrar a la discusión a estos temas que se están mencionando en este momento. La Relotaría está comprometida para seguir apoyando y apoyando todos los procesos que se vayan a dar.
Thank you so much. My question to Tarsila Rivera-Zea, we've been working together for a number of years, and I remember the process of consultations on SDGs, for example, Sustainable Development Goals. It happened globally, you know, from every biocultural regions of where indigenous peoples are, from all seven regions. So do we envision a process for the global action plan similar to that we've had so far? I think there is a need to consult with the constituency globally from every region. So can you share your ideas about the process and the consultations coming up to that, to the creation of the global action plan? Mm-hmm.
Lo primero que hay que hacer es enterarnos y hacer que nuestras organizaciones se enteren que existe un decenio para las lenguas indígenas, porque muchas veces no tenemos esa información no baja. Entonces se necesita construir un proceso, como mencionas, Galina, de poder recoger las diferentes iniciativas por regiones, pero luego construir uno global, porque esa experiencia hemos tenido. Sale desde las comunidades, los países, región y global. Ese es un proceso que hay que construir. Lo segundo es que hay muchas iniciativas ya que se desarrollan en diferentes lugares. Por ejemplo, hacer cine desde lo indígena en lengua propia. Y esto es una corriente nueva, pero maravillosa, donde las organizaciones indígenas estamos haciendo que la nueva tecnología sea apropiada por las organizaciones desde las comunidades. Ellos mismos reflexionen para qué sirve un audiovisual y expresarse en su propia lengua tomando un tema que lo sienten prioritario. Y son cortos, y Canadá es con Wapikón y otras organizaciones, siempre estamos en alianza, ¿no? Entonces, el usar la nueva tecnología para visibilizar, legitimar el derecho a usar la lengua propia, inclusive en el cine, es un aspecto que hay que apoyar. Cines, documentales o cortos, hechos por indígenas. Lo otro que yo veo que hay muchas iniciativas y que deberían ser compartidas es en qué medida, por ejemplo, la educación pública o nacional incluye los conocimientos y las lenguas indígenas para todo el país. Eso es importante saber. Si en el Canadá lo tienen, o en Estados Unidos, no solo están en las reservas, sino en un sistema educativo nacional, para justamente romper este prejuicio de la de los no indígenas contra lo indígena. Y porque es un derecho el de la movilidad nuestra también. No solo estamos en la reserva, estamos en libertad, movilizándonos a donde decidamos estar y estudiar en las universidades que nuestros jóvenes quieran, ¿no? Entonces, tiene que salir, tiene que ser una propuesta que sea más nacional, más pública. Y lo otro es que también, ¿no? Las iniciativas de programas radiales, porque la mayoría de los pueblos indígenas todavía somos de culturas orales. Entonces, las iniciativas que hay de tener programas radiales en lengua propia, tratando temas que ellos mismos eligen, es muy importante, sobre todo que nos da la posibilidad a la nueva tecnología cuando se tiene acceso a la tecnología. Entonces, a mí me parece que hay que compartir iniciativas, compartir experiencias, salir con las iniciativas de lo local para construir la agenda global, pero intercambiando los avances que hay en cada lugar. Me parece eso importante. Porque no tenemos que inventar nada. Iniciativas que hay en el norte, en el sur global, y luego vamos viendo, es la forma como hemos trabajado las mujeres y los pueblos indígenas, poco a poco, pero construyendo procesos. En ese proceso se invierte mucho tiempo, se invierte iniciativas, se invierte en recursos. Y una forma tan importante que la pandemia nos ha quitado, pero que nos ha mostrado que hay una tecnología que nos permite también escucharnos, es que la comunicación personal, interpersonal, desde nuestras propias culturas es muy importante. La ceremonia espiritual que nos incluye a todos en una forma circular, abrazándonos, sintiéndonos, es algo que no se puede reemplazar con la pantalla. Pero ojalá que ya regrese este espacio de encuentro personal y poder fortalecernos y revitalizar en realidad nuestras lenguas, pero también nuestras culturas y nuestros pueblos. O sea, van los actores sociales junto con su vida plena es lo que debe ser lo que nos oriente para fortalecer todo.
Gracias. Thank you again, Germana Tarsila. And I want to invite both Carla and Kate to share your final thoughts with us today. I think whatever you would like to share and emphasize as we're wrapping up this conversation, maybe on the global action plan, but maybe other things that you would like to share. Maybe Kate, I can ask you to come in.
Certainly. Thank you, Valina. You know, what occurs to me is I've written down all these words we've used for languages. They're cumulative knowledge, transdisciplinary knowledge, holistic knowledge, intersectional knowledge. The fact that language contains so many ideas and so many different ways of thinking and doing and being and moving and acting in relationship and all of those things. And it's so important. As Doña Torcila is saying, to mainstream those, whether it's through art, whether it's through advocacy, whatever it is. And I just wanted to take a moment to recall something that Carla had said, that it is a moment to be cautious in terms of where I sit when we work with corporate actors, that those concepts, that those words are possibly taken out of the context and used in ways that are not authenticated or, you know, used in the way that Indigenous peoples themselves would want them to be used. So it's a moment to protect and to ensure the protection of language, and that the benefit of the language and the knowledge and the intellectual property that it represents is truly protected. It's not a moment to pull, for example, the name of a nation, such as the Cherokee Nation, to use it on a car. And there's moments that I think as we mainstream Indigenous language, those could become real moments. So it is a call to action on the global level to enforce what WIPO and what others are doing to really protect the intellectual property that it holds, because it is important, it is sacred, and it is Indigenous. And so I think that's a moment there that is really important. And I'll just leave it by saying that on the other side of the coin, Indigenous language expresses value in ways that are really important and the world needs to hear. So where corporations, financial institutions, even advocates, states, and policies see value maybe in one lane, we can use language to express value in all of the lanes that are the most important and in all of the ways that rights are holistic, comprehensive, transdisciplinary, and come together. So I think the call on the global level is to recognize the power of Indigenous language to do that, and to be sure to articulate that those values come as a set, and that that's a set that can be set forward by Indigenous peoples themselves.
Thank you, Bairpa. Thank you. And Carla, invite you to share your final thoughts with us today.
Well, I mean, there's so much incredible work going on and incredible leadership out there. And from my vantage point now, the main focus that I have is that work needs support. And I think, you know, it's unfortunate. Someone mentioned the statistic about how few dollars actually flow to Indigenous communities from philanthropy. It's abysmal. It needs to be changed. And I think it's, you know, it's another mechanism by which Indigenous peoples continue to be marginalized. As I said before, these issues that impact our communities are holistic issues. They're not, they really shouldn't be in programs called Indigenous programs. They should be in programs across all foundations. And I also think, and we haven't really talked about this explicitly, but you know, there is an aspect of reconciliation that does require a reparative approach. And I think to Chief Littlechild's point about the cost of language suppression, we need to look not only at that, but at the losses that are attributable to language suppression, and really think about true reparations for Indigenous peoples. We talk about this a lot in the context of land loss, but reparations for culture loss should be on the table. And the impact of this has been really quite devastating. So I stand with all of you. I will do what I can to support from this vantage point. I think that there are other willing allies and co-conspirators, and I'm grateful again to Cultural Survival for this amazing conversation.
Thank you, Carla. This is, and all of you are just absolutely humbled to be in this space with you. As I mentioned earlier, you are Indigenous leaders who over the years have contributed to the implementation of Indigenous rights, our human rights, our rights to languages, our freedom of expression. It is humbling to be in your presence, and I thank you all. My gratitude is immense for your sharing your wisdom, your experiences, your life with your communities, with Indigenous communities globally. Just a quick shout out. Any final thoughts, anything that you would like to share before we close?
Just to... Everyone, keep up the good work, all of you. It's all about working together.
Thank you, Dr. Littlechild. With that, we're closing our first panel. Thank you again. There is a survey that you can find on Swapcard. The survey provides the data, baseline data on the state of our languages. So we can sprinkle this service throughout the program. please fill out. We need to understand where we are at the moment as we're entering the decade of indigenous languages. And with that, thank you so much. We'll see you in 40 minutes for the next session. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you and have a great day.
You too. Have a great day, everybody.